So, good afternoon, my friends. Today we are discussing another very, very important topic in our class, and that is the previous year MCQs, which we were not able to finish yesterday. Now, today we have very, very important concept-based questions, which I want to discuss in front of you. So, we will also be doing a little bit of high-yield point along with the points. Before going ahead, I just want to tell you, I'm Dr. Cheshita Agarwal, your dermatology educator. And I've myself scored All India Rank 261, so I'll give you the tips and tricks which you can use to solve your exam as well. Now, about Khan Academy, there are two very, very important points which I want to discuss in front of you. First of all, a very, very important point is, Khan Academy gives you an advantage of live interactive sessions, which means that in Khan Academy, you can have direct interaction with your educator during a live class. This benefit is not given to you by any other coaching center or any other online coaching center if we talk about. So with an academy, you can sit in the comfort or safety of your home and you can ask any doubt during a live class to your educator. So this is like a virtual class, a very, very plus point of an academy. The second thing which I want to discuss is we have two modules here on an academy. One is free and another is paid. Now, what do you mean by free module? It means that you have everything available for free on an academy on this free module. Now, what are the stuff which are free? These are the special live classes. So, live classes which is taken by all the educators of all the subjects. It is absolutely free for you. The next is quizzes and tests. It can be daily quiz, weekly quiz or monthly quiz, absolutely free. You have a vast question bank on an academy. And the last is the Unacademy Combat. What are Unacademy Combat? These are subject-wise fortnightly test, grand test, which occurs every 14 days. Now here the advantage is every day, every 15th day when you have combat, the winners will get amazing prizes. Either it could be an academy subscription or it could be the Amazon vouchers worth rupees from 1000 to it varies depending upon the cash price. Okay, so you have amazing prizes for this free an academy test series that is combat. Now what you all have to do to access any of these, you need to unlock them. So for unlocking them, you have a key and the name is Cheshita 10. So with the help of Cheshita 10, you can unlock any of the classes on an academy and you can have a clear cut access to them. Okay? So if you want to have access to special class, free series, combat, just type the referral code Cheshita 10 and you can easily access any of them. The next is the paid subscription. Now what are the paid subscriptions? Paid includes the design structured batch courses which are specially made for your upcoming exam. For example, we have batch courses for FMGE, we have batch courses for NEET PG, we have batch courses for INICT. So the paid courses are designed for that particular structured courses. Now you have two type of paid subscription. One is a plus, which give you access to live class, live test, batch courses, structured courses. And the next one is iconic, which gives you access of an academy along with that of the prep ladder. So with one subscription, you have access to both the best online platforms of the country. Now with Iconic, you can have a 1 year, minimum of 1 year subscription, which is around 55,000 rupees. And this will be best for your next 2022 exam. If you use the same key, which I've told you, Cheshita 10, you'll get the same thing in 49,500 rupees. And the next is for plus subscription, you have 1 month, 3 months and 6 months. You can have any of these if you're planning for NEET PG, if you're planning for INICT, or if you're planning for FMGE examination. If you're planning for any of these three examinations, just get a plus subscription. And yes, again, don't forget to use my referral code Cheshita10 to get additional discount on the subscription fees. So I hope everyone is ready. Please give me a thumbs up so that we can go to the next or the first question of the today's session. This is the first question of the today's session. I'll just move the picture so that you can see it clearly. Yes. Now I want everyone to answer the question. A patient comes with a cauliflower growth. He is farmer by occupation. Scrape shows falling. What is the diagnosis? You have 30 seconds. So you have 30 seconds to solve. What is the diagnosis? Chromoblastomycosis, rhinosporidiosis, mycetoma, or sporotrichosis. Very nice. So a patient comes with a cauliflower growth, and when you see these type of lesions, what are these? Can anybody tell me what are these lesions? Yes, these are copper penny bodies. Or they are also called as medullar bodies. So what are these? These are copper penny bodies. These are medullar bodies, which is characteristic of chromoblastomycosis. What is chromoblastomycosis? It is a subcutaneous fungal infection which occurs secondary to a pigmented dimorphic fungus which is called as Phyllophora species. Okay, so chromoblastomycosis, it presents with a cauliflower growth, and when you do the histopathology, you will see presence of characteristic copper penny bodies or medullar bodies or sclerotic bodies. Okay, so I think this question is clear to everyone. Should I go to the next question? Good. Please answer the next question on your computer screen. Arrange the following blistering disorders from superficial to deep. Very easy question. We have come across these questions previously as well. This is a new pattern question which we see nowadays in the NBE pattern examination. Arrange the following blistering disorders from superficial to deep. Pemphigus vulgaris, bullous pemphigoid, pemphigus foliaceus, or EB dystrophica. Quickly answer this. Arrange the following blistering disorders from superficial to deep. Very nice. Okay, so we should know where are the exact defect in all the four examples which is given. Now in pemphigus vulgaris, what is the defect? Anyone? Yes, in pemphigus vulgaris, you have IgG antibodies against the desmoglein 3 more as compared to desmoglein 1. And where do you see pemphigus vulgaris? Exactly at what point you will see pemphigus vulgaris? Pemphigus vulgaris will be present at the suprabasal level, that is just above the stratum basal level, because the level of desmoglein 3 is high at this level. Okay, I hope this is clear. Now next is the bullous pemphigoid. What do you see in the patients of bullous pemphigoid? In bullous pemphigoid, you have IgG antibodies against one of the component of basement membrane or hemidesmosome. So either the component of hemidesmosome, which is present at the lower part, or it is the adhesion substance which adhere the basement membrane to the stratum basale. So this is BP antigen 1 or BP230, or the component of basement membrane, that is lamina lucida, which is called as BP antigen 2. So what is the level? The level is basement membrane cleft. What about pemphigus foliaceus? Can anybody tell me? What about pemphigus foliaceus? Yes, very, very nice. In pemphigus foliaceus, you have IgG antibodies against the desmoglein 1, only desmoglein 1. Unlike pemphigus vulgaris, you will not see suprabasal antibiotic, or you will not see the presence of desmoglein 3. It is only desmoglein 1. So you will have presence of subcorneal, very, very superficial cleft, subcorneal cleft. Now, what is EB dystrophic? It is a mechanobullous disorder, which means that you do not have any antibody in this particular disease, but you have gene defect. And this gene defect will cause deficiency of one of the component of the basement membrane. In EB dystrophica, you have deficiency of collagen 7. Now, what are collagen 7? These are the anchoring fibers. What does it do? It connect the basement membrane to the dermis. So it is present just below the basement membrane, which is called as sublamina densa level. So it is the lowermost. So now if I ask you to arrange them, the most superficial one is the pemphigus foliaceus, which is at subcorneal level, followed by pemphigus vulgaris, which is at suprabasal level, followed by bullous pemphigoid, which is at basement membrane level, followed by EB dystrophica, which is present below the basement membrane. So the answer becomes 3, 1, 2, 4, and the correct answer is option number 4. I hope this is clear. There is no doubt about it. Please give me a thumbs up if all of you understood this very, very important question for your exam. Clear? Good. Chalo. You have another 30 seconds to solve this question. Quickly answer this one. A child present with target lesions on palm and sole, he also has oral mucosal lesion. What is the likely diagnosis? Herpes simplex virus, Coxsackie virus, Picorna viridae, or human papilloma virus? Anyone can answer this question? Yes, very nice, very nice. Absolutely right. This is a correct case, or this is an example of herpes simplex virus. What is the diagnosis? What is the diagnosis here? Very nice. This is a case of erythema. This is a case of erythema multiforme. Please remember, it is a classical case of erythema multiforme. Erythema multiforme, it presents with target lesions over upper limb or the face. This is the commonest site. You can see it over the lower limbs or other part of the body as well. Now, erythema multiforme, the most common cause is infection. And the second most common cause is drugs. In infection, herpes simplex virus is commonest, followed by mycoplasma. And in drugs, you have NSAIDs or sulfur group of drugs, which causes erythema multiforme like lesions. Please give me a thumbs up if you all understood this. A child present with target lesions on palm and soles, he also have oral mucosal lesion. So this is nothing else but herpes simplex associated erythema multiforme. The correct answer becomes option number 1. So this was also a repeat exam question. So I want everyone to remember this. This is again a very, very important. Chalo, let's answer the next question. A pregnant lady who is having chicken pox comes to you, the adverse reaction of this infection would be maximum to the fetus at. So when will you see the reaction maximum? Can you answer this one? When will you see the reaction maximum? 8 to 14 weeks, 13 to 20 weeks, 28 to 37 weeks, or 37 to 40 weeks? This is a basic question. You can get this question in microbiology, in even in your dermatology, even in your PSM questions, even in medicine, you can get the same thing. So what is the time when there is maximum effect? Very nice. Please remember, the maximum effect is at 13 to 20th week. After 20th week, the risk of infection to the fetus decreases. Please remember, this is a very, very important factual question. You can get a direct question on this, that 13 to 20 week baby can have maximum risk. The risk decreases after that. Okay? Let's move to the next question. A patient with leprosy was diagnosed on or was started on Dapsone. However, he developed complications of Dapsone toxicity. The investigation would be, what is the correct answer? A patient with leprosy diagnosis was started on Dapsone. However, he developed complication of Dapsone toxicity. The investigation here would be. Good. So please remember, what happens whenever the patient is given Dapsone, the Dapsone causes the formation of hemoglobin to methemoglobin. And methemoglobin have a capacity, reduced capacity of taking or carrying the oxygen with it. So for the detection of the Dapsone toxicity, you need to do the arterial blood gas examination for methemoglobinemias. So this is very important. These patients should be treated immediately because the methemoglobin have a reduced capacity to oxygen supply, and this can cause severe damage to the peripheral tissue. So the correct answer of this question becomes option number one, that is the arterial blood gas with myth hemoglobin levels. Please answer the next question, which is not true in Behçet's disease. Quickly answer this one. I hope you all know what is Behçet's disease. So the question says that what are not the points of Behçet's? Any one of you? 30 seconds. Which is not seen in Behçet's disease? Recurrent oral ulcers, erythema induratum, recurrent genital ulcers, and superficial thrombophlebitis. Now, what is, I will tell you first what is Behçet's disease. Behçet's disease, if you remember, we have discussed yesterday, it is a neutrophilic dermatosis. What do you mean by neutrophilic dermatosis? It means that there is accumulation of neutrophils in the skin. Either it can be in the epidermis or it can be in the dermis. So you have accumulation of the neutrophils. Now this neutrophilic accumulation will have a classical clinical presentation in the patients of Behçet's disease. They will present with oral and genital ephthus ulcer. So how will they present? They will present with oral and genital ephthus ulcer. The second feature, what will be the second feature? They will have ocular manifestation. They can have conjunctivitis, uveitis, scleritis, they can have any sort of ocular feature. Third is arthritis. Fourth is positive pathology test, which is an intradermal test. And the last is you have cutaneous features, which includes furunculosis, erythema nodosum. Erythema induratum is not the feature of Behçet's disease. Please remember, erythema induratum is a feature of tuberculid. It is a hypersensitivity reaction to tuberculoid infection. Okay? So erythema induratum is not correct. It should be erythema nodosum. Erythema nodosum is the correct answer. Okay? So I hope this is clear to all of you. So recurrent oral ulcers is correct. Recurrent genital ulcers are correct. Now what is superficial thrombophlebitis? Please remember, in the patients of Behçet's disease, you tend to see superficial thrombophlebitis, and they might lead to serious side effects if the thrombophlebitis is present in the CNS vessels. Okay? So they can present with symptoms of TIA, they can present with symptoms of hemiplegia, sometimes if there is CNS thrombophlebitis involvement. Okay? So please remember all these points. They are important features of Behçet's disease. Now quickly answer the next question. A very, very easy question, I guess. A patient presents with some red yellow staining axillary hairs. The likely organism causing this: Corynebacteria tineus, Corynebacteria minutissimum, Candida albicans, or Trichophyton. What is this? The yellowish staining of the axillary hairs. Can you answer this question? Can you, first of all, can you tell me the diagnosis here? What is the diagnosis? Yes, very nice. This is a case of trichomycosis axillaris. So this is a classical case of trichomycosis axillaris. But now, can anybody tell me what is the cause of trichomycosis axillaris? Anyone? What is the cause of trichomycosis axillaris? It is Candida, Trichophyton. Yes, this is a bacterial infection. Very, very important point. This is a bacterial infection. And what is the causative agent? It is Corynebacteria tineus. Very, very important. A patient present with some red yellow staining axillary hair, the likely organism causing this will become Corynebacteria tineus. So this is a misnomer. Very important for all my students to remember that this is a misnomer. This is not a fungal infection. It is a direct bacterial infection. Okay? I hope this is clear to all of you. Please give me a thumbs up if you understood this point. Chalo. Let's go to the next question. Quickly answer this one. I hope you can see the clinical image. I can shift the image a little bit for you all. Yes. A man, 30 year old, presented with pustular lesions. He has been taking the treatment for acne. His another acne lesions like papules and comedones subsided with the treatment. But the pustules which are visible, they are not subsiding and they are unresponsive to the medication. What is the correct answer? So we know that this is a case of acne. But the few lesions which this patient have developed, which are pustular lesions, they are not responding to anti-acne medication. Yes, very nice. This is a classical case of gram-negative folliculitis. What happens when you give antibiotics for a longer duration? It kills the normal commensals also. Whenever there is loss of normal commensal organism, the pathological organism which are present on the body, they tend to proliferate. So what happens when you give a long term of doxycycline or long term antibiotic, the normal commensal died and the new gram negative organisms start to develop. For example, Klebsiella, Proteus, they will start to develop over the face and they will give rise to follicular infection, which is called as gram-negative folliculitis. So for this, you have to give the patient a broad-spectrum antibiotic, for example, erythromycin, which will take care of both gram-positive as well as gram-negative organism which have grown. Okay, so this was a previous AIIMS question or NEET PG question, very, very important, high probability that it can get repeated again. So try to remember this, that on long-term antibiotic therapy, there is loss of normal commensals, giving rise to secondary proliferations of the gram-negative organisms. Okay? Chalo, let's do the next question. Metz Joseph space is a histopathological feature of. A very easy question, I guess, a very, very easy question. Metz Joseph space is a histopathological feature of psoriasis vulgaris, pityriasis rosea, lichen planus or parapsoriasis. Very nice all of you. This is a classical feature of lichen planus. Now what happens in the patients of lichen planus, I'll just show you with the help of a clinical picture. Now this is the stratum corneum. I hope everyone know. Stratum corneum have flattened cell or anucleated cells. So this is stratum corneum. Just below stratum corneum, you have 2 to 3 cell layer, which is nucleated, and it consists of granules. Okay, you can see this. So they have presence of granules and this is called as stratum granulosum. Granulosum. Just below this you have a polyhedral cell layer, which is considered to be the thickest cell layer. Can you name this layer for me? What is this polyhedral cell layer? Yes, very nice. So this polyhedral cell layer is stratum spinosum because they consist of spiny projections which helps in connection. Take it now just below this you have stratum basae. Which is a columnar, single layer columnar epithelial cell. This is stratum basae. Take it. This is stratum basae. Now what happens in the patients of lichen planus, you have destruction of the stratum basale. You have hydropic degeneration of the stratum basale cells. So when there is hydropic degeneration, they form a characteristic body which is called as colloid body or civet body or cytoid body. These are nothing but dyskeratotic bodies which are present at the layer of stratum basale in the patients of lichen planus. Okay? So stratum basale consists of colloid body, civet body and cytoid body. Now what happens with time, these bodies tend to get absorbed. These bodies tend to get absorbed. So this will go this will go, and this will go. So what happens? These bodies tend to get absorbed with time, and the empty spaces which are seen. So these are the empty spaces at the level of stratum basale. This is called as Max Joseph space. I hope this is clear. There is no confusion with this. Very important. What is Max Joseph space? It is a histopathological feature of lichen planus where you have basal cell degeneration, and with time what happens, these basal cells get absorbed, giving rise to Max Joseph space. This is a very important question. I want all my students to please remember it. Okay? So I hope this is clear, no confusion. Let's move to the next question. What is pseudo-isomorphic phenomena? What is pseudo-isomorphic phenomena? Quickly answer this question. What is pseudo-isomorphic phenomena? I hope you all know what is isomorphic phenomena. So isomorphic is nothing but another name for Koebner's. Isomorphic is also called as Koebner's phenomena. And pseudo-isomorphic means pseudo-Koebner's. Now where do you see Koebner's phenomena? You see Koebner's phenomena in lichen planus, vitiligo, and in patients of psoriasis. And where do you see pseudo-Koebner's phenomena? Pseudo-Koebner's phenomena, it occurs secondary to the auto-inoculation. And auto-inoculation occurs in infective conditions, for example, viral faults. So please remember this. This is very important. The pseudo-isomorphic phenomena, it is seen in the patients of warts. Psoriasis and vitiligo, they will have isomorphic or the Koebner's phenomena. This is very, very important, and I want everyone to remember this. Okay, a very easy question. Pseudo-isomorphic phenomena is seen in the patients of warts. Let's move to the next question. Which of the following statement is incorrect about pemphigoid? Can you answer this question for me? Which of the following statement is incorrect about pemphigoid? Okay, so which of the following is the correct statement about pemphigoid? The answer is, it is seen in elderly. This is absolutely true statement. Please remember, pemphigoid is a disease of elderly. So you do see pemphigus in elderly patients. There are flaccid blisters. No, this is a false statement. Please remember, pemphigoid group of disorder, the defect present below the epidermis. And we have discussed already, whenever the defect is below the epidermis, the disease have tense bullae. Okay? The third is autoantibodies against the hemidesmosome in the skin. That is absolutely true. And what is that antigen? That is BP-230 or BP antigen 1, where you have autoantibodies against the hemidesmosome. And there may be pruritus. Yes, this is true. Why there is pruritus? Because of complement activation. What happened? There is activation of complement system. And complement activation can give rise to presence of itching in these individuals. So all of them are true except option number 2, that they are consisting of flaccid bullae. Very important question, an NBE pattern question. So I want all my students to remember this. Let's go to the next question. I hope you can see the clinical image. If not, I can just move it for all of you, all my students. Yes. Now just have a look to this clinical image. A very, very easy question. About granuloma annulare, all are true except more common in diabetes mellitus. typically seen in homosexuals treated with steroids, or dorsal surface of hands and feet, usually ulcerative? Which of the following is the correct answer for this question? Anyone? Anyone can answer? Yes. So all of the following are true, except, please remember, more common in diabetes mellitus, this is a true statement. Typically seen in homosexuals, this is again a true statement, because in HIV individuals, those who are homosexuals, you will see it. Treated with the steroids, this is again a true statement. And dorsal surface of the hand and feet, this is again a true statement. The incorrect statement is you will not see the ulcerative lesions of granuloma annulare. What is granuloma annulare? It is a necrobiotic disorders. Necrobiotic disorders. What do you mean by necrobiotic? It means that here you have damage to collagen. Most frequently it occurs either because of sun, or in diabetes it occurs because of glycolated, because of excess of glucose or glycogen mediators which are present. So this will lead to damage to collagen. So collagenolysis is seen in necrobiotic disorders, for example, granuloma annulare. Okay? So this is, I think, a very, very easy question, nothing to explain here. And you can see here clinically there is presence of a very well-defined annular lesions with central normal skin. Now quickly answer this question. This is a multiple choice question, so I want everyone to put multiple options, and I'll charge my laptop. So regarding the differences between atopic dermatitis and seborrheic dermatitis, which of the following is the feature of atopic dermatitis? Look at the question. They are asking you which of the following is the feature of atopic dermatitis. More greasy, more red due to melasthesia, more pruritus, or more scalp involvement. Which of the following is the correct statement? Very nice, very, very nice. So regarding the difference between atopic dermatitis, which is true, atopic dermatitis, no, this is false. It is less greasy, because greasiness is a feature of seborrheic dermatitis. It is more red, yes, this is absolutely true. Due to melasthesia, no, false. Melasthesia is a feature of seborrheic dermatitis, not a feature of atopic dermatitis, okay? More pruritus, yes, again, this is true. You will see itching, very, very high itching or high intense itching in the patients of atopic dermatitis. And more scalp involvement, this is again false, because more scalp involvement is a feature of seborrheic dermatitis. Okay? It is a feature of seborrheic dermatitis. So the correct answer becomes option number 2 and option number 4. Okay, so atopic dermatitis is more red and associated with more pruritus. I hope this is clear. There is no confusion. I'll straight away go to my next question. Which all lesions are seen in secondary syphilis? Gamma. Gamma, condyloma lata, skin rash, alopecia, or canker. Which all lesions are seen in secondary syphilis? Please answer this one. So which all lesions are seen in secondary syphilis? Very, very nice. The correct answer of this question is gamma, no. Gamma is a feature of tertiary syphilis. Condyloma lata, yes. Condyloma lata are moist lesions which are seen in the patients of secondary syphilis. Skin rash, this is also true. This is seen in secondary syphilis. And alopecia, this is also true. You will see a characteristic moth-eaten type. You will see a characteristic moth-eaten alopecia in these patients. And what about canker? No, canker is a feature of primary syphilis. So canker is a feature of primary syphilis, and others are, you can see that gamma, condylomellita, skin rash or alopecia. These are the feature of moth eaten or the secondary syphilis. Okay? So answer becomes number 2, 3 and 4. A female patient presented to multiple warty lesions around the vulva. The lesions are gradually increasing. On examination, they are soft, sessile and did not bleed on touch. What is the likely diagnosis? Condyloma acuminata, molluscum contagiosum, chancroid or herpes genitalis. So a female patient presents with multiple warty lesions around the vulva. What is the correct answer of this question? Condyloma acuminata, molluscum contagiosum, chancroid or herpes genitalis. What is the correct answer for this question? Anyone? Yes, this is a classical case of genital warts. Nothing to understand. This is a classical case of genital wart, which is also called as condyloma acuminata. They will be warty in appearance. If you remember, I've told you yesterday how to differentiate the hemorrhoids from the genital wart. Hemorrhoids will be soft, smooth, but the genital warts will have warty appearance. They will have warty lesions on them. So here they are clearly mentioned that they are having warty lesions. So this is a case of condyloma acuminata. Okay? Chalo. A patient comes with the following lesions on his shoulder, chest. The lesions is having scarring and there is presence of activity in the center. So central scarring and peripheral shows activities. What is the diagnosis? I have moved the clinical picture for all of you. Quickly answer this question. How will you treat this patient? You can see there is a very well defined lesion which is present here. From here it is going like this. And you can see that there are areas of clearing which is present in between. So whenever you see a patient with annular lesion, for annular lesion you have three differential diagnoses. You have three DD. First, if the center is clear, what is this? If an annular lesion presents with clear center, this becomes a case of tinea. Dermatophytic infection. Now, if the center presents with crusting, can anybody tell me what will be the presentation if the center is having the crusting? Yes, if the center presents with crusting, this becomes leishmaniasis. And the third one is if the center presents with scarring. What will you see when the central is having scarring? You will see presence of cutaneous tuberculosis. The question clearly mentions that there is scarring in the center. I hope this is visible to all of you. It is clearly seen that there is scarring in the center. When you see scarring of the center, it means that you are dealing with a case of tuberculosis, cutaneous TB, and you have to give them anti-TB treatment. Okay, you have to give them ATT, rifampicin, isoniazid, pyrazinamide, ethambutol. So that is the therapy which you have to give in these patients. Take care. Chalo, please answer this. A child present with a scaly dry skin since birth. He has colloidal membrane at birth. A very important question. You can get the same question in pediatrics also. Child with scaly skin lesion since birth. Colloidal membrane at birth. What will you give to treat this patient? Very, very nice. Very, very nice. I think this is clear. Epidermolysis, hyperkeratosis, X-linked ichthyosis, lamellar ichthyosis or ichthyosis vulgaris. Yes, so everyone is right. For this patient, you will give, or the answer becomes lamellar ichthyosis. Please remember lamellar ichthyosis as well as non-bullous ichthyosiform erythroderma. Both of them will present with classical colloidal membrane. Okay, so they will present with the classical colloidal membrane at the birth. So this is again a very, very important point, and I want you all to discuss this, that a child presented with scaly dry skin since birth and he had colloidal membrane at birth. So the correct answer becomes lamellarichthyosis. Now please answer this one. I'll move the clinical picture a little bit on the left hand side so that you can have a look at this. Remember, I've just now told you, whenever you see annular lesion, look at the center. The center, if it is clear, the diagnosis of ptenia. If it is scarring, the diagnosis of cutaneous tuberculosis. And if there is crusting, it becomes leishmaniasis. So what is seen here? Yes, you can see a classical annular lesion. And what is present in the center? You can see that there is presence of clearing. So whenever you see an intensely itching annular lesion, with central clearing associated with intense itching, it is nothing else but a case of ptenia corporis. Please remember, this is a very simple, easy case. This was my own case who presented to the OPD with the presentation of this large size ptenia lesions. Okay? Chalo, good. Now going to the next question, the patient is having onychomycosis. He should be prescribed a nail lacquer. What will you give to this patient? Terbinafine, flucytosin, nystatin or amarolfin? So if you remember, I've told you that there are a new group of drugs which have come nowadays, which also affect the production of the cell membrane, that is lenosterol. So ergosterol, lenosterol production. So which is the answer? Yes, the correct answer is amarolfin. Amarolfin, it works on, or it is a cell membrane inhibitor. It is working best in the onychomycosis and it comes in a nail lacquer formulation. What is the other drug? Other is cyclopyrox. Both of them will be used for onychomycosis as a nail lacquer. Now please answer the next question. A patient presents with blue-purple asymptomatic lesions on the face on the sun-exposed areas. What is the likely diagnosis? Please look at the question. Bluish-purple. What is the color? Purple color. Now if you remember, I have told you, whenever you see purple color, it means that blue or purple color, it means that the pigment is present in the dermis. So you have to think which among the following will present with dermal pigmentation. Very important and a very easy question. This was an NBE pattern repeat question, and that is why there is a high probability of this question getting repeated. And yes, I can see many of you with the correct answer. The correct answer here is lichen planus. Please remember, lichen planus, because of basal cell degeneration, I've told you, there is degeneration of basal cell and there is formation of Max Joseph space. Now through these empty spaces, melanocytes fall down. These melanocytes goes inside the, where it goes? It goes inside the dermis, giving the skin a bluish purple pigmentation. Okay? So please remember a very important point about lichen planus. It will present with bluish color pigment. Now going to the next question, a 55-year-old farmer with a black mole on the cheek, which is increasing in size, becoming irregular, invading the deep tissue, what could be the diagnosis? What can be the diagnosis? It is invading the deeper tissue. Very nice. I can see many of you with the correct answers. A 55-year-old farmer presented with a black mole on the cheek. It increases in size, becomes irregular, invade the deep tissue. What could be the diagnosis? The correct answer is nodular melanoma. Please remember, whenever there is extension into the deeper tissue, that is the vertical growth, in all these three, what you will see? You will see that the growth is occurring in the horizontal manner like this. So this is called as horizontal spread. But what happens in the patients of nodular melanoma? I think this is visible to all of you. There is more and more of the deeper extension like this. and this is called as the vertical growth. Vertical spread or vertical growth, very very important for exam point of view. 55-year-old farmer with black mole on the cheek, increasing in size, becoming irregular, invading the deep tissue, what could be the diagnosis? Okay, so this is the answer. The correct answer of this question becomes nodular melanoma. Please remember, the correct answer here is nodular melanoma. Now, a patient with HIV has white plaque on the uvula, pseudo hyphae were seen. What is the likely diagnosis? Candidiasis, hairy leukoplakia, herpes, or squamous cell carcinoma. Patient with HIV has white plaque on uvula, pseudo hyphae. What is the answer of this question? Yes, the correct answer of this question is, whenever you see pseudo hyphae, what is it? It is the budding yeast which is forming a pseudo hyphae. This is a case of candidiasis. Please remember, candidiasis is a very very common opportunistic infection, or it occurs in the patients where the immunity is low. For example, organ transplant, diabetes, HIV, etc. Which of the following does not cause urethritis in male? Haemophilus ducre, Neisseria gonorrhea, Trichomonas vaginalis, or Chlamydia trachomatis. Which of the following does not cause urethritis in male? Can you answer this? Haemophilus ducre, Neisseria gonorrhea, Trichomonas vaginalis, or Chlamydia trachomatis. Which of the following does not cause urethritis in male? Very nice, all of you, very, very nice. The correct answer is, please remember, Haemophilus ducre is the causative agent for, yes, soft canker. And what is soft canker? Soft canker is nothing but a genital ulcer. So Haemophilus ducre will cause genital ulcer. This will not cause urethritis. Other than this, Neisseria gonorrhea, Trichomonas vaginalis, and Chlamydia, all three causes urethritis in the male. Okay, so I think this is again a very very interesting and an easy question. Nothing to explain here. I hope this is clear to everyone. Please quickly answer this question to me. Is this clear? Yes. Crystalline malaria is because of obstruction of. I think we have already discussed this. If not, please answer this question. Crystalline malaria is because of obstruction of sebaceous glands, sweat glands, hair follicle, or accessory sweat glands. Yes, the correct answer of this question is, it is the obstruction of the sweat gland. Very important, obstruction of the sweat gland. Next is, eccrine sweat glands are absent in. Quickly answer, a very easy one-liner. Eccrine sweat gland is absent in which part of the body? Palm, sole, mucosa, or upper trunk? Already discussed this one. Yes, it is the mucosa where it is absent. What part? Lips, clitoris, and what is the third thing? External auditory meatus. Please remember, you will have no eccrine sweat glands over these areas. Other than this, all areas are flooded with the eccrine sweat glands. Now, what is the reliable test for chancroid? Can you answer this question for me? Can you answer this question for me? Reliable test for chancroid detection. Yes, the correct answer of this question is Gram stain. What is chancroid? It occurs secondary to Haemophilus ducrei. And in Haemophilus ducrei, you all know that these are Gram negative organisms which will form a school of fish. This will form a school of fish or railroad track appearance. School of fish or railroad track appearance. Very, very important for you to understand. Reliable test for chancroid. So school of fish appearance, this is a classical case of chancroid. I think this is one of the very, very easy question. We are not going in detail. Where do you see pseudobulbo? Anyone? Chancroid, LGV, donovanosis, syphilis. Where do you see pseudobulbo? Can you answer this question for me? Where do you see pseudobulbo-like appearance? Chancroid, LGV, donovanosis or syphilis? Good. It is the classical feature of donovanosis. You will have no lymph node involvement. What is donovanosis? It is another name for granuloma inguinal, which occurs secondary to Kelimetobacteria granulomatis. You will see presence of beefy red ulcers with exuberant appearance, which bleeds on touch, but they will never have presence of, what is it, bubo involvement. So this is called as pseudo bubo appearance. Is that clear? Please give me a thumbs up if this question is also clear to you. Now next, where do you see safety pin appearance? We have only 4 minutes left. Quickly answer this. Where will you see safety pin appearance? Haemophilus ducreyi, chlamydia, donovanosis or mycoplasma? Where will you see safety pin appearance? Good. Please remember, the safety pin appearance is classical feature of donovan bodies. These are also called as bipolar bodies or donovan bodies. If you look them, this is the picture. They will look somewhat like this. They are present inside the macrophages and they will have bipolar. They have staining mainly present over the poles, and that is why they give you a safety pin appearance or bipolar appearance. Okay? Now, in which of the following conditions carpet tech sign is seen? This would be, I think, the last question of the today's session. We will end our discussion after this question. Which of the following will have the carpet tech sign? Lupus pernio, discoid lupus erythematosus, dermatomyositis or lupus vulgaris? Very nice. The correct answer is DLE. What happens in the patients of DLE? If you look at the skin in the patients of DLE, suppose this is the skin, these are the hairs. Okay, what happens? The scales, they get adhere. You have adherent scales in the patients of DLE because of scarring. And sometimes what happens, these scales get extend deeper like this. They extend into the deeper follicular part. So when you remove these scales, so if you have removed these scales like this, okay, so you have removed these scales and the lower surface of these scales will have projections like this. This is called as carpet tech or cat tongue sign. I hope you have seen the tongue of the cat. The papillae are very pointed. So this regular, the pointed appearance of the scales on the undersurface in the patient of DLE is called as the carpet tech sign. So I hope this is clear to all of you. And with this particular slide, I will end my discussion. I hope you all are enjoying the classes of Dermatology on an Academy. If you like my class, you have to give me a thumbs up. Please subscribe the YouTube channel, that is Let's Crack Neet PG. We have everything for you before your exams. Still your exams will revise you with all the subjects. If you like my classes, you can join my plus courses, which are more detailed classes where I will be telling you everything about dermatology. You can use the referral code CHESHTA10 for getting the subscription. Very, very important. And please don't forget to press the bell icon because this will give you notifications of the upcoming classes. So bye bye and take care.